Hi there, physics fans. So far in this series, I've told you about all sorts of interesting facts and observations that are either accepted theories or at least accepted problems, which some well-regarded theories are meant to explain. But particle physics isn't just about what we know. It's also about creative new ideas about the laws of the universe. For instance, researchers are rather perplexed about why gravity is so much weaker than the other known forces. Exploring one possible answer to this question sounds like a great topic for this episode of Subatomic Stories. So what do I mean about gravity being weaker than the other forces? I mean, scientists always say that, but what do they mean? The strength of the forces depends on both energy and distance, and each force changes in different ways. For instance, at galactic scales, only gravity matters. But if stars and planets had electrical charge, electricity would dominate. And what we call the strong nuclear force is completely irrelevant to you personally. It has zero strength when objects are separated by a distance larger than the size of an atomic nucleus. And at most energies, the weak force only extends out to about a thousandth the size of a proton. So when we talk about the strength of forces, we need to pick a scenario in which to compare them. The standard scenario is to calculate the strength of the force between two stationary particles separated by a distance that is the radius of a proton, or one femtometer if you want to hang a number on it. At such distances, the strong nuclear force is the strongest. For simplicity, we'll call that strength equal to 1. Electromagnetism is about 1% as strong, or 0.01. The weak nuclear force is 0.00001. And the strength of gravity is about 10 to the minus 40. I say about because you get different answers if you ask the question with two protons, two electrons, or an electron and a proton. But the bottom line is that gravity is very weak. And by very weak, I do mean very. Neutrinos are governed by the weak force, and they interact so little that they pass through the Earth. Gravity is unimaginably weaker than the weak one, and that, as they say, is a huge curiosity. Well, the other forces are equal-ish in size, meaning within a factor of 100,000 or so of one another. Comparing the strength of gravity and the strong force is like comparing the size of a proton to the size of the visible universe. So why is that? Well, truth be known, we don't know. But an idea was proposed back in 1998 that was a possible solution. It involved extra dimensions. Now, people often misunderstand what scientists mean by extra dimensions. Scientists don't mean parallel realities or parallel universes like the Star Trek storyline where Spock had a beard, or in Robert Heinlein's later fiction where protagonists jump from reality to reality. Extra dimensions doesn't mean that. What scientists mean by extra dimensions is literal additional dimensions of space beyond the familiar up, down, forward, backward, and left and right. Now, on the face of it, this sounds ridiculous, right? I mean, after all, it's clear that we live in just three dimensions. But let's just take a moment to see how extra dimensions might help. To do that, let's compare what happens if you compare a one-dimensional world to a two-dimensional world. Start with an object that generates a certain amount of force. In a one-dimensional world, the force can go in two directions, left and right. Each direction gets half the force, and it doesn't spread out, so the force doesn't feel a change with distance. In a two-dimensional world, the force spreads out in all directions. We can draw a circle around the object, and we see that the force flows through that circular surface. Furthermore, the size of the circle depends on the radius, so the amount of force that flows through each little piece of the circle gets smaller as the radius gets bigger. You can do the same thing with three dimensions, and we see that now the force spreads out in a sphere. With each additional dimension of space, the force gets spread out over a bigger surface and appears weaker. But the strength of the force isn't changing. What's changing is the size of the surface the force goes through. So that's the idea. Maybe gravity isn't weaker at all. Maybe it's just going through more dimensions than the other forces can. Now, obviously, we can see that there aren't more dimensions, so we can rule this idea out, right? Well, not so fast. Not all dimensions have to be big like the ones we know about. It's possible that other dimensions can have different properties. For instance, suppose at every spot in space there's another dimension in the shape of a little hoop. To figure out the location of an object, we need to give the standard three-dimensional location of the hoop, but we need another measurement, another dimension, to locate the object on the hoop. It's somewhere on the hoop. That's a four-dimensional world. Now, shrink the hoop down to invisible sizes. The world still looks three-dimensional, but there's a tiny and hidden fourth dimension. And if gravity can enter that small additional dimension, and the other forces can't, then gravity will appear to be weaker than the other forces, even though it isn't. What's different is the amount of dimensions of space that the different forces can enter. Now, there's no evidence that these extra dimensions exist, and trust me, we've looked. Heck, I've looked. But that doesn't mean that they don't exist. They could be smaller than we can see with the existing equipment. We're going to keep looking, but the first pass over the data revealed nothing. The idea of extra dimensions is a pretty cool one, and I want to draw your attention to another video I made on the subject. It's got great things in it, including super cool physicists, although I guess that's redundant. It also has multidimensional ants and a giant talking rabbit. It's well worth your time, and I put a link to it in the video description below. Check it out. And, speaking of checking things out, let's check out the questions our viewers have for us this week. I love question time. What question is suitably weighty for our first episode on speculative physics? Wait, I know. How about one about koalas? Several viewers were very emphatic that koala bears were not actually bears. Now, I know all of that biology and stuff, but seriously now, this is just mean. I mean, somebody told this guy he was a bear, and he tried to look all fierce. He's pretty clearly channeling his inner bear. And this guy here, are you telling me that he's not a bear? If you ask me, it looks like he has all of the necessary qualifications. Am I right? Does he look disqualified to you?
Don, man, you gotta just stop.
Okay, I'll move on. But it's a shame. I was just getting on a roll. I even had more puns. Great puns. In fact, all of my puns are the very highest quality. Mr. Wild Bill 47 asks, if the weak force is present inside stable atoms, then what does it do? Hi, Wild Bill. Sure. The weak force exists anywhere there are particles. It's just like gravity, which also exists inside atoms. It's just that the other forces are stronger and the weak force has minimal effect, like a whisper at a rock concert. However, the existence of the weak force in atoms has been observed, and I put a link in the description if you want to learn more. Zyman Basinski asks if it's correct to call gravity a force given how it is characterized in general relativity. Hi, Zyman. Yeah, that's a hard question, and the specific answer depends on the theoretical framework one uses. Within the context of Newtonian physics, gravity is quite obviously a classical force. Within the framework of general relativity, it equally obviously isn't. Gravity is the motion of objects on paths that follow the curves of a distorted space-time. However, we also know that general relativity fails in the microcosm. There, we imagine a theory of quantum gravity for which no successful model has been devised. In such a paradigm, the gravity arises from the exchange of particles called gravitons. It's largely similar to the exchange of photons of electromagnetism. Getting back to your question, is gravity a force? Colloquially, it obviously is. Beyond that, the definition of the word force comes into play. If there is a quantum form of gravity, then it will exhibit the features of quantum forces. We'll need to devise a correct theory of quantum gravity, and then maybe we'll be able to better answer your question. Bottom line, it's a tough question with no definitive answer at the moment. Sagar Wadhwani asks, what happens if a neutron and a muon interact? Hi, Sagar. There are a couple of answers to your questions. If a muon passes near a neutron but doesn't hit it directly, basically nothing happens. The neutron has no electrical charge, so the muon ignores it. However, things change if the muon directly hits the neutron. If that happens, the muon is close enough to see the distribution of quarks within the neutron, and this means that the muon can emit a photon that hits a quark, causing the muon to recoil. The muon goes off one way, and the quark absorbs the photon's energy and goes off the other. Basically, once a muon hits a neutron, the situation is essentially the same as when a muon hits a proton. And this kind of experiment has been conducted since the 1970s, when muons are shot at both hydrogen and deuterium nuclei. Hydrogen contains only protons, but deuterium has protons and neutrons. So we know what's going on in the scenario you asked about. Samuel Machado notes that general relativity describes the bending of space and time by matter and energy, and asks if all forms of energy must be considered. Hi, Samuel. Welcome back. Yes, all energy contributes to the distortion of space-time. However, not all energy is of equal impact. Matter is a particularly dense form of energy, so matter is generally a much bigger deal. That fact allows for scientists to make approximations to Einstein's theory, which makes them easier to solve. However, there are situations where gravity is super strong, where the energy of gravity must be taken into account. In that situation, you have to use the full equations of general relativity, and if you do that, be prepared for a headache, because they're really hard. Mondragara asks for some advice on science communication and wants to know the biggest barriers. Hi, Mondragara. That's an interesting question. I think the key to being a good science communicator is to know your audience, and don't assume that you know your audience, because you're almost always wrong. Ask someone who knows them and adjust your presentation accordingly. This is the most important thing. Some other things. Most people don't care about the details. Scientists love details, and that's a problem because they often talk about minutiae when most people want to know the big picture. But I figure if I tell them 95% of something they didn't know before, then they know a lot more than they did. That last 5% takes even longer to explain, and they can dig into that if they want, but most people just don't want to know. Finally, I think many academics don't understand the power structure in science communication. Most academics are used to a classroom where teachers teach and students are expected to learn under the penalty of a bad grade. But in popular communication, the power structure is reversed. If people are not entertained, they can always switch the channel. Furthermore, people remember some of the science you tell them, but they remember more how they felt about hearing about it from you, so likability is important. Bottom line, be likable, give the big picture and skip on details, know who you're talking to, and don't speak over the heads or down to them. And if you're serious about this, I recommend a book by Randy Olson called Don't Be Such a Scientist. Mike Norville asks if there's any evidence that a theory of everything exists. Hi, Mike. Actually, no, none. It's a prejudice. There have been many examples of unification in the past, from gravity and electromagnetism to the electroweak unification of half a century ago. We just kind of imagine that the trend will continue, but we don't know for sure. But in the meantime, we'll keep looking and trying to figure things out. What you asked is a great question. And speaking of great questions, this week was fun, but I'm afraid we're out of time. If you like the video series, please like, subscribe, and share. And come back next week for another fun episode of Physics, which, as I'm sure you will agree, even at home, physics is everything.